Good morning, everyone, and welcome to English Worship. It's a joy to be here together with you this morning. Before we begin, I'd like to invite you to find a space where you can feel comfortable worshiping the Lord, and as well to join in singing the songs when you feel comfortable. Psalm 147 says, "Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting." Would you join me in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this morning. Thank you for just yet another opportunity that we have to worship you together as the body of Christ. As the psalm said, a song of praise is fitting. And so we ask that these songs that we sing to you would just help us to reflect on truth, the truth of the gospel, that you would send your son Jesus to die for us. And we pray, Lord, that that truth would just have permeating effects all throughout our lives, and that it would be the motivating factor for everything that we do, everything that we say, everything that we think. And I ask, Lord, that you would allow us to turn our hearts to you and turn our ears to you in this worship service today. And we ask that you be glorified by everything that goes on this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Died my soul. welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood 'neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Trust in Jesus, just to trust.
morning, everybody. This morning, we're going to pray for missionaries. So could we bow our heads together and pray to our Heavenly Father? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for creating us, for creating this world. And when you created us, you knew that we would fall into sin. Nevertheless, your love continue to love us and redeem us. You sent your son Jesus to die on the cross so that our sins are forgiven when we put our faith in him, Lord. In Christ, we're no longer condemned, but we're restored to have you in our life again, Lord, to be freed from the power of sin in our life, Lord. We thank you so much that in Christ we have hope. In Christ we have this desire to want to share the gospel with others so that they will not perish. So Lord, we thank you so much for calling missionaries in this world to preach the gospel. And you have given us the Holy Spirit to witness to those who do not know you yet, Lord. We pray for the missionaries we support at CCIC, as well as all the missionaries around the world, Lord, that you continue to make your calling certain in their lives, Lord, by providing them love and joy and strength to carry on. Lord, we know, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic, they may feel even more isolated, more helpless, Lord. We pray your spirit continue to minister to them. You use your word to comfort them and give them strength, Lord. I pray, Lord, even as they face persecution, hardship, they do not give up, but they look onto the cross for strength, for determination, Lord. I pray, Lord, that they know you call them to be ambassadors of reconciliation. I pray that they remember from Romans chapter 10, that you call them so others will know the Christ and help them to stand firm and give them your ways, Lord, to relate to the people of the country where they're in, to establish relationship and trust, and to open the doors for the gospels to be preached, Lord. So we pray for them. We pray that they continue to receive prayer support as well as financial support so that they can continue with the work in the field, Lord. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So I pray, we pray as a church, Lord, that we will continue to support them with prayer, like right now, and also financially. It's an honor for us to do that, to support the missionaries, Lord. You call us to do that. So help our church to continue to communicate with them and support them, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much that you call each one of us to do your work, to be in this church, united by the Holy Spirit, to share the gospel with others. We are also missionaries, Lord. So give us a heart of love, a heart, an eye to see who needs help and to encourage them by sharing the gospel with them, Lord, so that you are glorified. You are lifted up, Lord. So on the day you return, you see all these people that we have talked to and pray for, and you will be pleased, Lord. We pray the day that you return will be a day of glory, where as we and the missionaries carry the cross, that cross will turn into a crown of life, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for calling each one of us to be your sons and daughters, Lord. And we just pray that everything we do is for your glory and your glory alone. We also want to pray for Ron as he preaches this morning. Will edify us, edify the whole church, and again, bring glory and honor to your name. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning to you this morning. The peace of the Lord Jesus be with you. Today marks almost the 10th week that we've been sheltering at home. And we all have to adapt to this new reality. And some of us have used this term called the new normal. And we adapt to this new normal of work from home. We adapt to a new normal of responsibilities to care for our families. And we adapt to a new normal of silence and even stillness, perhaps even boredom for some of us. But whatever that each of us have to adapt to, in this change of new normal, I believe that you and I are actually given a very crucial opportunity for reflection. And from reflection, I think that there's an opportunity for spiritual growth. Because when we really think about it, and when we're completely honest with ourselves in our reflection, I think that our reflection helps unmask some of the illusions that many of us have believed in. And specifically in this time of COVID-19, the illusions that are being unmasked are the worldly securities that we might have put our hope and our trust in before. So I remember several conversations that I've had with before moving to the Bay Area, and various people told me about two things about the Bay Area. And one, the first one is that it is an incredibly work-oriented culture, and so people work a lot, and there's not a lot of time for a lot of other things, right? Work seems like to be the most important thing for many people in the Bay Area, and that's the first thing. And the second thing that people told me was that the Bay Area is really comfortable, right? Most people have everything they need, right? Whether it is a well-appointed house or a car or vacations or the beautiful weather and also the amazing food that is in the area, right? So people in general are really, really, really comfortable. But in reality, these comforts often blind people from the need of God. Now, I'm not saying that we should feel bad about having these things or even that we shouldn't even enjoy them. But often and easily, I think we let some of these things create an illusion of being secure. And a lot of these securities have been broken during this time of COVID-19. And for some people, everything that they know is being shaken. And this forces them to reflect on the question, what do I really depend upon? Now, what do I put my trust in? And we might begin to realize that the previous things that I mentioned, we find actually ourselves putting our security and our trust in those things. And again, I think the opportunity is a tremendous opportunity for us here is that we begin to look to a truer place, to a real place for security. Imagine with me, what if you and I come out of this season more dependent upon God? What if when we meet again in person, we notice the character change that you and the others around us are more dependent upon God? And I think that's what The psalm that we have this morning that we're going to study is going to teach us and help us understand how do we deepen our dependence on God. And I hope to help us answer two questions this morning. The first is, how do we even start to depend on God? And second, how do we deepen that dependence? And so this is a continuation of the series that we've been on, the integration of faith and life, where we try to see that every part of our lives, whether we are working, playing, or resting, in our relationships, are all under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So let's pray together before we get started. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for gathering your people this morning together. God, even if the medium of the gathering is not perfect, we ask that you would feed our souls with your word. Create a thirst in us for you this morning, God, and convict our hearts. But we don't want just behavior modifications, God, through moral lessons. God, what we want is, and what we really need is transformation from the inside out by the power of your Spirit. So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, our Rock and our Redeemer. So would you open your Bible with me to Psalm 121 this morning? And I'll be reading from the NIV version. Let's read this psalm together. Psalm 121, a song of ascent. I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. So a few words about the background of this psalm. Like Kevin mentioned a couple of Sundays ago, the book of Psalms is really multifaceted. And what I mean by this is that the Psalms is a prayer book that has many, many different types or categories, if you will. There's praise, there's thanksgiving, there's laments, there's more. But Psalm 121, along with 14 other psalms around it, is in its own special category. They're all a part of this group of psalms called the Songs of Ascent. And if you look in the subtitles and under each of these psalms, you'll see the subtitle of Song of the Ascent. Now, what are these psalms? The word ascent here literally means steps or stairs. So these, in terms of walking psalms, they are songs that people sing when they walk on a journey. And what's the journey, you ask? So most scholars think that these are songs that the pilgrims would sing when they travel from their home to the center of worship, to the temple, to Jerusalem. And now most of us have never been on pilgrimage before, at least I haven't. But perhaps you can imagine that it's kind of like the routine of yearly going back to your home for Thanksgiving or for Christmas. Or maybe if you're really steep in the Chinese culture, going back to your home every year during Chinese New Year. There's a sense of anticipation of joy and reunion when you get to the destinations. But the travel can also be really tiring and really tedious, right? So that's the background of this psalm. It is a song for pilgrims. And they sung this while they were journeying, walking, and traveling to Jerusalem. And many times for festivals. Now, as we pay close attention to this psalm, one single theme really emerged out of it. And it is the theme of dependence on God. And it first helps us with the first question that we have. How do we start depending on God? How do we start depending on God? So the first verse of this psalm says, I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? So the first aspect of dependence on God, it starts with when we recognize our own helplessness. When we recognize our helplessness, that's when the dependence on God starts. And notice again, this statement that the psalmist make, how it coincides with the background of what we just talked about, right? You can imagine him walking up the hill after hill, all he sees in front of him are mountains. And mountains can be obstacles, right? Mountains can even be filled with danger. After all, isn't it extremely tiring to go up a hill? And if you even hike alone before, there's a sense of a vulnerability that you feel. Anything can happen, right? You can slip, you can twist your ankle, you can step on a snake, you can come upon a wild animal. So every time, even back in time, as we remember in the story of the Good Samaritan, that the robbers might just be around the corner. So all I'm saying is that as the psalmist lifts up his eyes and he sees these mountains on the horizon, he, I think, is apprehensive or even fearful of the danger that are coming. And that is why he cries out, where does my help come from? But perhaps the psalmist also see the mountains metaphorically as the obstacles of dangers of life. Right? Because isn't it true that life is full of challenges, right? Like we say that life is full of mountains. I know that when I look back in my own life, I can recognize that each stage of life, there's a challenge, there's a mountain, right? Moving away from home for college, finding a career, starting a new job in a new place, difficulties with health. Life, really, if we really think about it, is full of mountains. And now the second part of this verse 1, there's a very valuable question that the psalmist is asking. And I think we need to ask the same question. So the psalmist see all of these mountains and he cries out, where does my help come from? Pause here and notice that the psalmist doesn't just say, I will conquer this mountain. But he, in fact, recognizes and admits his own helplessness against his tremendous difficulties of the mountains and of life. Friends, this is a point that I think we really cannot miss. Because if we do not recognize our helplessness, we will never really truly start to depend upon God. And I think that's why this pandemic, with all its terrible consequences, give us an opportunity for reflection. Again, when all of our securities are shaken, our identity from our job, the amount of income that we have, the stock market, the relationship, the future plans that we have, when all of these are shaken, what will it reveal? Perhaps it will reveal to you and I that we have somewhat put our securities in these things. So don't waste the opportunity for reflection here. I challenge you, sometime this week, take 30 minutes, take an hour, just bring out a journal or a piece of paper and answer these two questions. Honestly, where have I put my securities in life? And do I recognize my own helplessness? Now, as we recognize our helplessness, we begin to look for help, right? And where do we look? So the psalmist continues to teach us, which brings us to the second part of how to start depending on God. If the first one is to recognize our own helplessness, the second part of starting is to look for God for help. Now, this might sound really simple, and I admit when I wrote this, I thought this is too simple. But in reality, sometimes the simplest can be the hardest things to actually put in practice. So, and because when some of us experience helplessness, it's easy to do one or another thing. One thing is that you might go into actually a frenzy of trying even harder, maybe exhausting yourself, doing everything that you can to get out of the situation of helplessness, right? But you can also vacillate around the other thing that you might simply do is just to give up. Let fate take its course. And the reality is that for most of us, we'll probably vacillate between these two, right? But I think the psalmist teaches us a third way here. And the third way is to continue walking up into and up the mountain with God as our help. Notice that the psalmist in verse 2 says, "My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." Notice that the psalmist declares that one person and one person only, God, Yahweh, is the only one who can help him. No other gods is his help. And this is significant because remember in Israel's history, since the beginning of their nations, from Exodus, you know, all the way to the kings, you see over and over again that the people always look to other gods for help. Whether it's when they were trapped in front of the Red Sea and they wanted to go back to serve Pharaoh, or when Moses was up on the mountain and the people started to panic and started to build their own golden calf. Or throughout the book of the Kings, where the kings have generally led people astray to worship other gods and other idols. So you see, the psalmist's declaration here is really important. The psalmist says, no other god, no other securities, only Yahweh is my help. And notice that he brings us all the way back to Genesis, saying that in the beginning, God created heaven and the earth. And here again, it says Yahweh, the creator of heaven and earth. So I want to ask you, as you recognize your own helplessness, the next step is, do you actually turn to God for help? Do you actually turn to God for help? And there was a season when I was reflecting on it, this was a season that I was unemployed. And being unemployed is extremely difficult. Not only is this the loss of income, but it's the loss of identity, loss of purpose. Unemployment is hard and depression can even settle in. Now, I admit that I vacillated between the two. I either go into frenzy mode or I went into the give up mode. Right? And by the grace of God, I stayed in the third way, and that is throughout it, I was able to, by God's grace, to stay in the middle, to walk up that mountain of unemployment with God's help. The only thing that kept me going was knowing that God is the creator of heaven and earth. He knows me. He loves me. He's in control of heaven and earth. So if you are one of the 36 million of people in this nation who is unemployed right now, turn to God for help. Turn to Him for help. And that is the second part of starting our dependence on God. So far, we've learned that from this psalm that the deepening of our dependence on God starts with admitting our own helplessness, and also to actually look to God for help. And so now we begin to move to answer the second question that we have this morning is, so how, once we start, how do we deepen that dependence on God? And here's the answer. It's really simple. The answer is that we deepen our dependence on God when we understand and when we experience God's character. We deepen our dependence on God when we understand and experience God's character. And that's what the rest of the psalm focuses on. What is God like? What is His character like? And if you look, the predominant image here is that God is a keeper. Notice that 6 times the word is used for the rest of this psalm. And depending on the translation that you have, you see God is described as keeper, or the one who keeps, or as the NIV that we read, as the one who watches. Now, both are correct because the word means to keep, to watch, to guard, and to observe. I like how a famous preacher, Charles Spurgeon, explains these words with the following analogy. He said the word keep is also full of meaning. He keeps us as a rich man keeps his treasure, as a captain keeps a city with a garrison, and as a royal guard keeps his monarch's head. Now, no analogies are perfect, but I appreciate these analogies from Spurgeon because it shows us that God keeps, watches, because the thing and the person He's watching is important to Him. Perhaps I can add another analogy. It's the analogy of a loving mother or father who watches over their son. And so during this COVID-19 times, Monica and I was able to go on some hike with Josiah. And when we are on hike, I noticed that we are always on a constant alert. We always say to Josiah, stay close to us, you know, watch your step here, social distance, single file here. Or, you know, we tell him that, you know, mountains lions love little kids who just wanders off by themselves. Okay, trust me, Josiah is having fun when he's going on these hikes. But what I'm trying to say is that the psalmist reminds us that God is one who's watching us, not with a suspicious eye, not with a judging eye, but with the eyes of love that watches out for us for danger. And so not only is this the predominant character of God highlighted in this psalm, but it is also the first characteristics that I want us to meditate and to reflect upon. That God is one who sees all circumstances and all times. You will notice that in this verse 3 and 4, you will notice that it describes God as the one who does not slumber or does not sleep. God is watching. He never stops watching. And this image of not sleeping reminds us of the story of Elijah and the prophets of Baal, right? And you remember in the story of 1 Kings, when there was a showdown essentially between Yahweh and the prophets of Baal who serve this foreign god Baal. And you know the story, right? The showdown was that whoever that the altars were built, and that the real God will send fire down to consume the sacrifices that are on the altar. And the prophets of Baal call over and over again, day and night, and there was no response. So Elijah says this to mock them. It says, at noon, Elijah began to taunt them. Shout louder, he says. Surely Baal is a god. Perhaps he's deep in thoughts or busy or traveling. Or maybe he's asleep and must be awakened. And you know the end of the story. The end of the story is that God shows up because he was not sleeping. God was not asleep when the Israelites suffered at the hands of the Egyptian. God was not asleep when Elijah needed to prove that the prophets of Baal was wrong. God is not asleep now, even as the world is in a pandemic. God is not asleep in your situation. He sees, he hears, he sees, and he acts. I think that's a characteristic, especially during this time, that we need to meditate and reflect upon. But now, what good is it if God watches, but he's not powerful enough to address the situation? So as we continue on this psalm, that's the second characteristics of God that we can learn and meditate upon. Let's read verse 5 and 6, you recognize that the characteristics of God that appear is that God's power is supreme. Right? The verse 5 and 6 says, the Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. Now, what is all this talk about the sun and the moon? Well, I think it's apparent that, you know, if you spend any time outside, you know that no matter how much SPF rating sunscreen you have on, the sun can be really unforgiving. You will get burned, right? If you stay there outside long enough, then the sun is strong enough. So I think one way to look in verse 6 here is that the sun and the moons are these exceptionally powerful entities that the psalmist is facing while he's on the way to Jerusalem. And then left to his own, he's powerless against them. But notice what the passage says about who God is. Even the strongest and perhaps the most dangerous entities, the sun and the moon, cannot harm those who are in God's care. God's shade is at our right hand, and shade gives protection and refreshment. This is a declaration in saying that God's power is supreme. So friends, I hope that you will again meditate and reflect on this truth during this COVID-19 season. What are the suns and the moons in your life right now? Is it the uncertainty? Is it that things are not going as the way that you want it to? Is it that you just have no hope for the future? What are your suns and the moon? This psalmist calls us to remember God's power is greater than we can ever imagine. So I encourage you to spend time, cast your burdens upon him. And we move to the last characteristics of God that we can learn from this psalm. It's that God is the Lord of all of life. God is the Lord of all of life. Look at verse 7 and 8 with me. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. So notice that by the end of this psalm, the focus has really expanded to the greatest degree. What I mean is that from a simple cry for help in the beginning, the psalmist looking to the mountains, to his foot slipping, to being protected from the sun and the moon, now it expands to all harm, to all of life, to even all of time, from the present to eternity. So, but we can assume that the psalmist is not unaware of all the hardships of life. The psalmist has to remember, even as he walks toward Jerusalem and the temple, that the nations of Israel has experienced tremendous difficulty, right? Slavery, wilderness, battles, exiles. And we must ask, how is it possible that he sings these words out loud? I think that the answer is not so much as to what he experienced, but the who of he experienced them with. So not the what he experienced, but the who he experienced them with. God is his companion on this journey of life. Again, I want to put this quote up by Spurgeon. He says, "When we go out in the morning to labor and come home to eventide to rest, Jehovah shall keep us. When we go into youth to begin life and come in at the end to die, we shall experience the same keeping. Our exits and our entrance are all under one protection." Do you believe this? Do you believe that every single moment of our lives are filled with the possibility of encounter with God? So whether we are working or playing or resting or cooking or gardening or driving, studying, changing diapers, making coffee, watching a sermon on YouTube, every single moment is filled with the possibility of dependence and the possibility of God's presence. And I think when we truly realize this truth of God's character, our dependence on Him will really deepen. Now, some of you, as we end our time together, some of you might be wondering, all of these sounds really, really good for the Israelite. Of course he can sing this. He saw all of God's wonder and all his works. But how do I know that I can also sing this psalm that we read this morning? Isn't this just naive optimism or empty hope? And I believe that all of scriptures anticipates and find its fulfillment in Jesus Christ. Isn't that true here also? Isn't it true that when we look at our mountains, not just the mountains of life's difficulties, but the greatest mountains, our sin, don't we also cry out, "Where does my help come from?" And isn't it true, knowing that we can't help ourselves, the Creator of heaven and earth Himself came down through His Son Jesus to save us? And isn't it true that Jesus showed the Father's character of watchfulness, protection, love, and compassion when He didn't let the most despised and downtrodden slip out of His hand? Jesus saw, heard, and touched. And isn't it true that at the Garden of Gethsemane, while every one of His trusted friend fell asleep, Jesus did not slumber. He did not sleep. Instead, He prayed for strength to endure and for God's will to be done. And isn't it true, most of all, that we were no match to the greater power of oppression than the sun and the moon, the power of sin and death? The verdict has been pronounced. You and I were guilty and destined for eternal death because of our sins. Scripture tells us clearly that we were helpless and powerless in the grips of sin. Romans chapter 5, verse 6 tells us that, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Jesus demonstrated that God's power is supreme over sin and over death in His life and resurrection. And finally, isn't it true that God has truly become our companion for every single moment of our day through the Holy Spirit? In John chapter 14, verse 16 and 17 says, "And I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth." If you trusted in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the Spirit right now is residing in you. Right now, even as my voice reaches your ears, right here, like the psalmist says, this moment and every moment into eternity, God is our companion. So friends, I challenge you to use this pandemic as an opportunity to deepen your trust and your dependence in God. Begin by recognizing your own helplessness. Then start to realize that there's no other place to turn to but God alone. Then begin to reflect and meditate on God's character that are in this psalm. And finally, we know that the words of these psalms are not naive optimism or empty hope. We know that because Jesus Christ has come and he will come again, and his life, death, and resurrection is the greatest testimony of the rescue plan that God has done for us. So I ask you to reflect and meditate, because then I believe that as you do that, you will turn to sing this song like the psalmist once did. And your worship will lead to a deepening of dependence on God. Amen.